Morning, everyone. This morning, I'm overwhelmed with weight of humility and anticipation. For some of you, this is coming home.
Very graphic in
demonstrating what that might mean, and just to sum up a thought that we had there. So we talked about predator and prey, and how in the animal kingdom there are predator animals and there are prey animals. And if you want to call in a predator animal, you just make the sound of a wounded prey animal, and a predator will come. That's a guarantee. If you want to attract the attention of God, worship. Make a sound in worship, and God will come.
Amen.
You make a sound of a wounded animal, whining, complaining, bellyaching, and all that stuff. Guess who's going to show up? Guess who's going to show up? It won't be God. You'll attract the wrong person, a predator. Anyway, that sums up yesterday or last week's sermon. It was really short. If you missed it, you should have been there. We were out in 5 minutes. So what does it mean to stand? So I will title my message, Stand, Part 2. So it's only 5 minutes, so hang in there. Simply to stand would mean that you agree with. You're standing with your marriage partner after many years, you're obviously still agreeing with. What's interesting about Jesus is that he is referred to as a lion in Revelation 5:5. He's referred to as a lamb, John 1:29. He is a lion and a lamb. So this reflects two aspects of his nature. He can be very aggressive, and he has been through what he accomplished on the cross, and he will be when he comes back the second time. He's also very soft. He was willing to lay down his life for the likes of you and I and the rest of humanity. For people that aren't even born yet. A lion and a lamb. You and I carry that same reflection. We have the ability, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to be very aggressive and stand against whatever wants to come at us in an aggressive way. We have the ability to say stop in the name of Jesus. Very aggressively. Not that we demonstrate aggressively. Good. But we can do it very quietly as well. Stop in Jesus' name. And that's kind of what we talked about last week. About that kind of an assertive posture in the Lord where we take control. Issues don't take control of us, we take control of them. And out of that comes peace. Today, we will focus on being a lamb. And what that means. Jesus is not called a sheep. Have you ever noticed? He's not called a sheep. He's not referred to as a sheep. He was one kind of a sheep. He was a lamb. Not just any lamb. He was a sacrificial lamb. Not all sheep qualified to be sacrificed. Back in the day when Israel would perform sacrifices for the sin of the nation, not all sheep qualified, not all lambs qualified. There was a segment of lambs that qualified to be a sacrificial lamb. And historians believe that on Jesus' birth, when the shepherds were tending their flocks, it was a flock of sacrificial lambs that they were tending. You and I, yes, we are the sheep of God's pasture. Are we any sheep, or are we sacrificial lambs? And I suppose that could be up for debate. Right? It could be some goats in the herd, and some sheep, ordinary rascally old sheep. Our choice, our decision, our pursuit is to be a sacrificial lamb. In Ephesians 5:27, it talks about the church. You know, when they brought this pulpit in, it felt like home to me. It was a foreign place to listen to arrive. Hallelujah. So in Ephesians 5:27, nice pulpit, it talks about the church without spot and wrinkle, without any blemish. That's what this sacrificial lamb was. It was a perfect specimen. Perfect specimen. No blemish. It could not be the one-eyed one. It couldn't be the one with the broken leg, the one with worms and the skin, going to die anyway. Yeah. When they would bring their lamb in for sacrifice, the priest would look at it, and it had to pass inspection. We are that lamb. We're not just any sheep on the hillside. We are that perfect lamb. We want to be. It's our choice. It's our option. That perfect lamb without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. So this leads into something that is very interesting. It leads into servanthood. That's how we would describe it in human language. In sacrificial Latin language, it means you give your life for somebody else. In human terms, it means you live for somebody else. Or you're just a servant. A servant. This is possibly the challenge of the human heart, is to be a servant. Whoever came up with that name. Like if anything were right today, this thing, living for somebody else. A sacrificial lamb did not live for himself. He was born to live for somebody else. It wasn't about him. It was about somebody else. We struggle with that. In Romans 12, verse 1, says that we should not conform to, depending on your translation, the image of this world, the pattern of this world, or the spirit of this age, but be a living sacrifice. Here's where we struggle. The human heart says, What about me? What about my hurts? What about my disappointments? What about my struggles? What about my failures? What about my dashed dreams? What about my latest wreck? What about me? Who cares about me? What about me? And in our affluent society, we have evolved as a country, as a nation of people, where we are affluent. We have so much at our fingertips. We want to go on a holiday. We want to buy a new house. We want to get a new vehicle. If we want, whatever we want, we can probably do it. What about me? What have we got ourselves into? And the sacrificial lamb says, it's not about me, it's about somebody else. Jesus said something quite staggering at the time to his audience. In Matthew 20, verse 26, he's looking at a group of aspiring apostles who know they're on to something. And one time Jesus says, the works that I do, you'll do as well. In John 12, 14, 12. This may have come up on other occasions. It's only recorded once. These guys knew they were onto something. And they were feeling pretty good about themselves. And arguing amongst themselves who's going to be the biggest shot. And Jesus says, if you want to be great, be a servant. Be a sacrificial if you want to be great. I find it so interesting that he said, now you guys will be doing miracles. You'll be raising some folks from the dead. You'll be doing all sorts of bizarre things. But just remember, be a servant. No. He didn't include none of the big stuff. He said, if you want to be great, what does it mean to stand for the Lord? Yeah, there's a part about doing miracles. There's that part about standing up in the face of whatever enemy and saying, stop in Jesus' name. There is that part of standing. But to stand as a lamb, to stand as a servant, to somehow find a balance between me and them, and finding the balance of being a servant and yet meeting your own personal needs. That balance is very different from one person to another. But to stand for the Lord includes being a servant. So a test, how we're doing. In Matthew 13, Matthew 5, verse 13 and 14, Jesus says, you are salt and you are light. If we are salt, truly, if we are salt and we are light, we are standing. And if we are standing, we will be salt and light. Simple test. Salt and light makes a difference. Right? You eat food, not enough salt. And big on pepper and salt. You can skip the salt, but don't hide the pepper. But salt makes a difference. Maybe you can pour it without salt and stick to pepperoni for the salt. Light makes a difference. Light makes a difference. And so this is a test for ourselves, how we're doing as a servant. Are we making a difference? Is our contribution make a difference? And if we, without sounding judgmental, if we are not making a difference in somebody's life, are we light? Are we salt? Let's not go there. That would be depressing. So let's talk about something happy. And truthfully, standing as a servant, it does mean different things to different people. It could involve personalities. It certainly involves gifting. Some people are gifted to be more visible. Some people are gifted to be in a prayer closet. Nobody would see them. But they're standing. Some are gifted playing drums. There's a variety of ways to stand as a servant. A very good example of that is the parable of the talents, where one was given 10, 5, and 1. They were all given a chance to stand. So it's not about who's gifted is what, and who's got a better personality, and it's got nothing to do with any of that. We bring to the table what we have. And if we don't bring it, we're not standing. And that's terrible. I'm trying to make this happy and positive, but I'm not sure how I'm doing so far. Think of it this way. Success or failure in life is directly related to servanthood. Factor in that everything in life has to do with relationship. Okay? Friends, family, marriage, children, driving your car down a busy road, you have a relationship with the other vehicles, and the guy in front of you who thinks he's a snail. Business, work, whether you're a boss or being employed, there's relationships everywhere. It's servanthood. And the attitude of a servant is not manifest in any of those scenarios. It's a recipe for failure. Success or failure in life is directly related to having the heart of a servant, where we consider the other person higher than ourselves. We are not just any sheep. We are the sheep of his pasture. Indeed, we are. But we are specific sheep. We are the sacrificial lambs. We were born. We were born again as sacrificial lambs. And we live for somebody else. We live for somebody else. Wouldn't the world, indeed, wouldn't care me be a better place if everybody lived for somebody else. And if we would just get over me, my hurts, my baggage, my past, my offenses, what they did to me, what he did to me, what she did to me, what the boss did to me, what my neighbor did to me, what my pastor did to me. If we can just get over me, it's pretty exciting to stand in a place of authority and power and see demons tremble in front of you.
Yeah, that's exciting.
And it is. And exciting might not be the right word, but it makes for a great story. It makes for a great story. Had it all in my face. Fists, knives, handguns, brutal, brutal anger. Stop in the name of Jesus. Stop. And it works. All makes for a great story. What about the stories of servants? And it's going to be our turn, and you're going to be talking about us at our memorial. What makes a better story? The stop part? Or who could fill their shoes? It'll take five people to fill their shoes of everything that they did. Really? There is an aspect of standing for the Lord that is so powerful and so consuming and so accomplishing and just slips under the wire and nobody notices it. Well, not nobody, but it can easily go unnoticed. And it's being a sacrificial lamb, being a servant, living for somebody else. I admire churches who, and I think of one specific one, we attended a conference at where, albeit it was a larger church, at the time they had 120 ministries out of that church. Yeah, they had a couple thousand people, whatever. But they had 120 ministries out of that church. Pastor said, somebody comes to me and says, you know, Pastor, I think we should have a ministry to the bikers. And he said, I think so too. You're the minister. Get it done. I think we should have a ministry to the prostitutes. I think so too. Get it done. On and on and on. And that church was utterly amazing. They had a ministry for everything. And a thriving ministry. Thriving ministry. The success of any church, any non-profit organization, whether it's the Elks, or the Legion, Flower Club, or church, any non-profit organization, the success or failure is servanthood. I think we should do this. I think so too. You're in charge. Make it happen. Now wouldn't be a good time to talk about the me aspect. The success of a church is how much servanthood floats to the top. That determines what we can accomplish. Whether it talks about giftings or abilities, whether it talks about our personal finances, what we're willing to contribute, it just covers everything. Our success as Caramias Community Church is how many people are willing to serve and just come up with brilliant ideas. Why don't we do this? And only our imagination would either limit what we could come up with or reveal what we could come up with in an effort to reach the hurting. It's not about us. We're here this morning. Can we say, we're not here because of us. We're here because of them. We're here because of them. I mean, we benefit from being here. I enjoy your company. We enjoy each other's company. There is benefit to gathering. We had a nice time worshiping the Lord. Meaningful time. Appreciated the word that Jeff had. There was more that could be attached to that. And we well may hear of it in the future. There is value in gathering. But at the end of the day, it's not about me. It's not about me. And that we could just learn to understand. Amen. Jesus qualified on both fronts, being the aggressor and being the good guy. At 10:38, Jesus went about doing good, being a nice person. Don't know what he did. Maybe with his carpentry background, he took somebody's squeaky door, readjusted their hinges, built him a new chair. Took it over as a surprise. I have no idea what he did by being good. Don't have much record of that, if any. And he healed the oppressed and those who were afflicted by darkness. And we have much account of that. Oh, yeah, we could talk about that a long time. There's a song. Can we go up there? We're going to conclude with a song. We did miss part of the read. Too late. We missed that part. If you want to be great, learn to be served.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord. I just have a reflection on what Pastor Wayne talked about. And I think that when you stir our creativity, stir our talents and giftings and the things that are on our hearts, keeping in mind that this is a new day, sometimes we can get to, we tried that as well. Or, we tried that before. I heard it was, I said something and you're really regular with it. But this is a new day. It's a new season. It's a new place. I just want to stir our creativity right now for things that, as Pastor Lynn was talking, something came to your mind and said, wow, that would be something that we could do, something that we could try. There's ministries out there. There's ministries in this room right now that are waiting. We're pregnant with it. We're just waiting for them to be birthed. They really are. There's lots out there. We are so special, individual people, and each of us has something that we'd like to do or help with or an idea. And so this morning, I just would really encourage you to just take this week and stir your heart. Stir your mind, stir your passions. Things that you're passionate about. Go to the Lord and say, hey, is there something I can do? Maybe there's something you've always wanted to do, but just didn't have the place to do it. I know that there's a place for you here because you're here. You're here for a reason. Everyone has a reason for their what God has for you. But this morning, and I pray that you be your best you. And that may include something new. New building, new ministry, new creativity, new ideas. So right now, we just stir the Holy Spirit, stir those things in us. Thank you.